Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to NYU Washington, D.C. My name is Michael Ulrich, and I'm the director here. And I want to start off by acknowledging a few members of the team who've helped bring this event together. Tom McIntyre, who some of you may know, is our assistant director and does all of our special events. So we're very thankful for his expertise in all of this. And then Nick Mariletti, one of our students, actually really helped organize this event today. So I wanted to give a special shout out to him as well. I'm pleased to welcome you to the Abramson Family Auditorium at our newest global site for this timely and relevant discussion about how elections are shaped by the shapes of our electoral districts. For years, politicians have known how powerful redistricting can be for elected officials to protect friends and undermine opponents. Both parties have exploited the ability to redistrict, minimizing the role of voters in the political process. This gerrymandering leads to most incumbents facing only token opposition and partisan distortions within states and the nation overall. But the problem may be less redistricting than the very fact of districting itself. This dialogue, in partnership with Fair Vote, will look beyond gerrymandering and heighten political polarization to statutory solutions grounded in our nation's history. We gather here today to debate the changes we can make today, how to replace gerrymandered winner-take-all elections with nonpartisan voting commissions, provide fairer representation for women and racial minorities, allow both major parties and independents to compete in one-party strongholds, and ultimately put voters in control of their own representation. And without further ado, I'll turn it over to Rob Ritchie from Fair Vote to introduce our panelists. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Michael. This is just a terrific place, a terrific opportunity to have this partnership with NYU and a wonderful panel. This is the first in a series. The next one is going to be July 9th, looking at the right to vote in the Constitution. We have Congressman Pocan among speakers, Rashad Robinson of Color of Change. July 25th, we'll be looking at presidential election reform, and August 19th at the State of Women's Representation, and we hope continuing the series from there. This particular topic gets at the core of what Fair Vote has worked on for 21 years, which is the issues of representation, voter choice, and the structural barriers to us having what we would like to have in a democracy that's truly representative. And we'll have a really good opportunity to go through that topic. I should say that you will, in the course of this, have opportunities to ask questions. We're going to do the writing down questions way of doing it because we're quite tight on time. We also, by the way, are this is being live streamed, and it's going to be in a video archive, so it can be online forever. So all the wise things you say will be something you can go back to and watch again and again. But I am very pleased to welcome our chair, Chris Novoselic, who is here today from Washington State, and you may know him as a musician. But if you read Salon, you may know him as an electoral reform wonk, and he is a remarkable partner in our efforts for reform. Mr. Novoselic.
Thanks, Rob, and welcome, everybody. It's nice to see folks here today. So this is the first in the series, as Rob said, of these events on election topics at NYU. So Rob approached me, said with the idea that we were going to have these panels, and he said, you want to be on the first panel? I said, absolutely. And then the panel started to come together, and I'm like, these are some really good folks. And you know how panels goes, there's only so much time. So I decided that I'm not going to be on the panel. And then so Rob wasn't happy about that. He goes, well, what are you going to do? I said, well, you know, I'm known for playing bass guitar, and I've actually been obsessed with accordion lately. So maybe I could have a lecture about the association between the accordion and the bass. And then Rob was like, that doesn't really fit the scope of these things. And so I just thought I'd just say a few words on how I got involved with Fair Vote. And it was like in 1997 with music issues in Washington State. It's how I got my education in civics, is just trying to fight censorship bills and trying to open up the music community, have more inclusion in the music community. And along the way, there seemed like there were all these barriers to participation with like voting. And I started doing the research. I was on Alta Vista at the time. And there was one group in the United States promoting things like proportional representation, ranked choice voting, instant runoff voting, and it was Fair Vote. And today, there's one group in the United States doing the doing the same thing. So I got involved with Fair Vote, and I started to learn about these American systems. I had a misconception that these are like parliamentary systems. They're these low thresholds. And so I learned that it's American systems. They're candidate based, and it's a good cure for what's a lot of the problems today with like polarization, gerrymandering, and even today in my Salon piece, you can read about how these forms of voting speak to the Voting Rights Act and how there's going to be changes. So I'm really excited to be the chair. I've been chair since 2008. A Fair Vote, and did you mention the reception at all?
I have not.
Yeah, okay, so we're gonna have a reception after this event, so if you wanna talk about election reform or accordion or bass playing, just hang out and we should have a good time. And so with that, I'll turn it over to Rob, the moderator, and our distinguished guests.
Thank you, Chris. I will, so everyone can hear me from where I am, I assume, and actually all the speakers can stay there, or if they like to move, they can come up to the podium. We will shortly be joined by Jamie Raskin, a law professor and Maryland State Senator, who I thought would set a sort of a tone for what this is like down in the field of Maryland. But he will come in soon and be able to talk about that story. So I'd like to move straight to Congressman Porter. And we're really fortunate to have Congressman John Porter, who won 11 elections to the U.S. House of Representatives, 1980 to 2001, a Republican congressman from Chicago area.
North of Chicago.
but as he'll tell you, first elected by cumulative voting, one of the voting systems that Chris just talked about. Someone that I've had the good fortune to work with on the issue of instant runoff voting, redistricting reform, just to know some of the things that Congressman Porter is doing today. He's a partner of the law firm Hogan Lovells, and serves as chairman of Research America, the boards of the Foundation for the National Institutes for Health, PBS Foundation, First Focus Campaign for Children, and Brookings Institution, a wonderful reform partner. So thank you, Congressman.
You want me to start? Okay. Thank you, Rob. This is a wonderful organization that all of you probably know. Does wonderful work in this field, and it's a real privilege for me to have the opportunity to talk to you. When about the turn of the century in 1900, Robert La Follette, a senator from Wisconsin, put in primary elections, and it swept the country as a reform. It was a real reform. It made a difference because it took party bosses out of the process of choosing the candidates and theoretically at least put it in the hands of the people. I think we're at a place today where we need to reform that process, because if you look at it, of course, it's not in the hands of the people. It's in the hands of the extremes of both parties, who are the people who vote in the elections. Moderate voters, my district was a very independent district. I'm a moderate Republican, I should be in a museum. But moderate voters today, I believe, are disenfranchised. They have no real participation, where you have a gerrymandered district that's been gerrymandered every year for years and years, and closed primaries. They just have no chance to meaningful participation. So one of the things I wanted to tell you today was about what my law firm is doing to try to address this. And I went to our pro bono division. We have 2,400 lawyers all over the world, each of which is required to give 20 hours of pro bono work to the firm. That makes 48,000 hours of pro bono work. And it's the oldest pro bono division in among law firms in the country, and really does wonderful things. I went to them and said, is there a way that we can take a situation where you have closed primaries and gerrymandered districts and perhaps provide a lawsuit to change that and challenge it in court? So they've done some research on it. When we got the research memorandum from one of our very brilliant young associates. My wife's brother is a professor of law at Harvard. In fact, the associate was in his classes and he remembers her. So I went to John Hansen. I said, John, can you get to Larry Lessig and Larry Tribe and let them see this work and see what they think about this? We got a reply from both of them. They're both writing books, so they can't devote a lot of time to it. But the replies were encouraging, and they suggested that perhaps we ought to go to law professors all over the country who specialize in this area and get their opinions and see where we can go. So we are about to send out a further memorandum to five different law professors who specialize in this area, get their opinion, and try to move this thing forward. Now, I can talk about it because we don't have a client. If we had a client, I'd have to get permission to talk about it. But I'm hoping that maybe Fairvote would like to be our client if this thing is to go forward. And we'll see about that very soon. But I'd like you to know about it. We're working on it. God knows we need reform in this country, and this may be a way to address it. My fallback position, Rob, is to go to a state that has an initiative that is active and used successfully in the past and try to get on the ballot a citizen panel that would do both legislative and congressional districts and adopt instant runoff voting in the one election that is the pure form and see if we can't get all these groups that seem to be carrying in the same space, for example, No Labels claims they have 700,000 members. What do? Well, let's get them to go out into a state and get the signatures on an initiative referendum petition and get the thing before the voters and see if we can't make some real reform that may be the beginning of sweeping the country and actual making changes. So that's what we're doing. And I just wanted you to know about it. We don't know if it's promising yet or not, but if it is, we're going to ask you to be the client and try to move this thing ahead. Do I have any time left?
Yeah, I think you do. And, maybe one question I would just have is maybe that experience. Who here has heard about cumulative voting? Some of you. You have some Fairvote wonks here. So maybe you could just briefly explain cumulative voting and how it was different from how we elect people.
When I was elected to the Illinois General Assembly in 1972, we had senatorial districts within which three members of the House would be elected, so that each voter would go to the polls with three votes to vote for one, 1.5 votes to vote for two, or one to vote for three different candidates. It made for every district in Illinois, every legislative district, to be two of the majority party, one of the minority party. That meant that the parties did not have control. Where did this system come from? It came from the 1870 Illinois Constitution. It had been in effect for 100 years, and everyone thought it worked very well. When I got there, there was very little party control. Bills were individual bills. I would go to the Democrats and to the Republicans both and shop the bills that wanted to get them to co-sponsor and bring and sit down, talk to them, get to know them, work with them. Harold Washington, who became mayor of Chicago afterwards, was right across the aisle from me. I'd go to him, say, Harold, this is a good bill. And I did it to everybody in the General Assembly. So in the year that Illinois then had a 1970 constitutional convention, they readopted multi-member districts. In 1982, a reform was put through the initiative process on the Illinois ballot that changed the whole system to single-member districts, and it was called the Cutback Amendment because it also reduced the size of the House from 177 to 118 members. It passed. And so today, if you go down to the Illinois General Assembly, you will see a House, as well as the Senate, where the majority party goes into their conference, decides what they're going to do, comes out and votes in lockstep. There's no independence of any of the members of the General Assembly. And in addition to this, the governor, who was the head of the reform movement in 1982, is now having to live with what he created. Because he's a Democrat, the legislatures of both houses are Democrats, and the Speaker of the House runs the show, and the governor works for him. So it's a reform that never happened. If you want to take a state that you want to reform, and it has an initiative process, Illinois would be ripe for it. Everybody hates the legislative body, and I would say its approval rating is 5%, perhaps. And you could run it against it if the parties are against it, we're for it. I think it would be a winning people would be for it, and I think it'd be a winning combination. So thanks, Ron.
Thank you, Congressman. We will hear more about cumulative voting, but I wanted to say we are having this conversation in a week where it's very important to have this this conversation. Supreme Court stepped in and struck down a central provision of the Voting Rights Act that has an effect on a whole swath of the country, particularly in the South. The idea of winner-take-all.
By the way,
yes?
Half an hour before I came here, the associate that's working on this wrote me about that very thing and said there's some kernels probably dicta in there that might really serve us for this. Mm.
Fascinating.
Yeah. So I'm sorry to interrupt.
And the idea of winner take all in a racially polarized environment takes on another dimension, right? So you have a party dimension, which is what we see in congressional elections, where more than 90% of House races are locked up for one party, as the congressman was talking about, and that's winner take all single member districts. But then they also can have racial dimensions, particularly in some of these areas. And now the way that the lines are created are going to be that much less under a control that will make sure that they are empowering the full community, particularly in the South. And I'll just say that, for instance, when we talk about competition and the fact that in Illinois, when it had cumulative voting, three-seat districts, pretty much every district had shared representation. You had African Americans early on in the 40s and 50s starting to win seats outside of Chicago and in areas where they were in the minority. If you go to the South, say, and really all over the country, about 40% of state legislative seats do not have a contest between even two parties. And Georgia, South Carolina, the Democratic Party didn't even run in half the districts. We're just in a state of sort of winner-take-allism. And in that respect, I'd like to turn it over to Senator Raskin. Great to have you here, Jamie. Jamie is a former board member, sort of a permanent champion of democracy. Winner. He was our first class of Champion of Democracy awards. He has also been a law professor and a true champion within the state Senate in Maryland, but has a personal story you can tell about how that means with when it comes to redistricting and what it means for reform. So thank you for joining us, Jamie, and I'll turn it over to you.
Great. Thank you for having me, Rob. I'm delighted to see so many people and such an interest in an absolutely critical issue, and I just want to start by saluting Fair Vote for really being in the forefront of a whole range of electoral and democracy practices that we need to be innovating and brainstorming for the new century. But I am with Fair Vote and with John Stuart Mill that if there's an election and somebody gets 52% of the vote and somebody gets 48%, the party that gets 52% should not get 100% of the seats. It should be reflective of what people actually want. Now, having said that, then, turning to my personal story, I will begin with a confession. I gerrymandered. I'm the majority whip of the Maryland Senate.
And Jamie, it's up on the screen now.
It's up on the screen, okay. I'm the chairman of the Montgomery County Senate delegation, okay? And so I want to give you a personal existential story to try to dramatize what's really at stake here. Now, when we went into the 2012 redistricting, there were six majority Democratic seats and two majority Republican seats out of Maryland's eight seats. And so the pressure was on from the National Democratic Party, but also within Maryland, to see if we could squeeze out one more seat. This is the name of the game. To my mind, redistricting is gerrymandering. There's no difference between them.
The moment that you let politicians or anybody draw single member districts, it is going to be a gerrymandering process. And so we were writing against the background of intense gerrymandering going on in Republican controlled legislatures. Let me give you a couple examples, because this was fresh in my mind when we sat down to do it. Ohio, which has 16 congressional seats, which was won by Barack Obama twice, meaning that the Democrats commanded majority support in the state in the last two election cycles, was drawn in such a way that there are 12 majority Republican seats, 4 Democratic seats. In North Carolina, another state won by the Democrats in the last two presidential cycles, it was drawn in such a way with 9 Republican seats, 4 Democrat seats. So both of these are better than 2-1 gerrymandered in favor of the Republicans. So it comes to Maryland, and the pressure's on in the caucus to squeeze out another Democratic seat. Can we go from 6 of 8 to 7 of 8? And now I've got my fair vote, fair elections hat on, and I've got my partisan ardent Democrat hat on, and I say, look, there's got to be a better way of doing this. And I started to talk to people about proportional representation and so on. But of course, the political realities of the day had to govern, and I had to go along with it. And when I got up, you know, the Republicans were crying foul when we drew a 7th congressional district blue, which was the Western Maryland seat. And they said, that's not fair. We've only had 2, and now we're all pushed into the Eastern Shore with some squiggly lines up in the northern part of the state. And I got up and I said, you're right, it's not fair in Maryland, but it's fair vis-a-vis what's happening in North Carolina and what's happening in Ohio. We're all condemned by this terrible system of gerrymandering. It is an arms race that nobody can win, and I am certainly not going to advocate unilateral disarmament by my party in Maryland, which is a medium-sized state where we could only get 1 extra seat, and we've got better than two to one Republican advantages being drawn by Republicans controlling the state houses in Ohio and in North Carolina. I'm just not going to do it. But I would absolutely support moving us in another direction nationally, which means either 1, we need congressional direction, or 2, we need interstate compacts to make it happen. Now, on the congressional direction side, I don't know. The House and the Senate can't even seem to agree like when to adjourn. I don't know if they could come up with a system of proportional representation that would please everybody. And the fact of the matter is that the Republicans lose when you add up congressional elections nationwide, but they're able to win because of the gerrymandering that's taken place in states like Ohio and North Carolina. So one party is now deeply invested in the system of gerrymandering. So maybe we can do it with some interstate compacts. That is, imagine a state that's exactly Maryland size that has roughly the same political demographics, but in reverse. We could say, rather than both of us go our own way and stick it to the other side, we would engage in something like this. So with Fair Vote's help, what we drew up was, instead of the bizarrely drawn districts that we've got in Maryland, 2 big super districts, basically drawn, you know, with a line down the middle of the state, and then 4 members would be elected from each one, or there's another way to do it where 5 would be elected from one and 3 from another. And it would probably end up with something like 6-2 in terms of the partisan representation, but it would certainly empower political minorities of all types, however defined, in racial terms, ethnic terms, ideological terms, somebody wants to run as an environmental candidate or what have you, to go out and say, I can get 25% of the vote in one of these districts. And so it would promote more competition and more representativeness. Right now, you know, the mistake is for people to say, well, all we need is these nonpartisan expert commissions. If they get together and do it, everything's gonna be fine. Well, that's of course not been the record. And the reason is they're still operating within the structural constraints of the single member district territorial system. And when you do that, if you draw the districts more competitively, you draw a 51-49, maybe you've made 1 or 2 of them more competitive, but you've made them less representative, because now 49% of the people don't get somebody they want. If you make them more representative, so it's an 80-20 district, you made them less competitive. So we're sort of in a bind there, unless you move to multi-member districts and use one of the proportional representation systems that people have a hard time keeping in their head. But I think that's really the challenge for fair vote. People get the values and they get the principles, but it's to translate the mechanics of making it happen to people so they understand it's tangible and real.
Thank you. Just on the factual side of things, we have single member districts, but we don't have to have single member districts. It's a statutory matter. In fact, in the first 50 years of the country, there were a number of states that did not use single member districts. We've never had congressional elections by a non-winner-take-all system, but we did in Illinois. Their system's based on voting for candidates. There's ranked choice systems that are used at a local level that open up the political process. It's a statutory decision. It's our political will. Just because we might have to lose the congressman due to a votes that could come up on the floor, I would like to introduce Congressman Keith Ellison, who has just been a champion of democracy, which we will be making clear later after the panel, on a number of issues. But we have been pleased to work with his staff this year as they've taken a lead role with Congressman Pocan on a right to vote in the Constitution, having an explicit right to vote in the Constitution. And he has, for years, been a leader on Election Day registration, standing up for voter access, and in his home city of Minneapolis, the use of ranked choice voting. Congressman Ellison.
Thank you. And real honor to be here with this panel and all of you. It is important that we have a full room today because we need people excited to have the political will necessary to really make our electoral systems much more fair. The truth is that the problems with the system, however you define them, do have an impact. I mean, in 2008, when things went like great guns, we had big turnout. Remember that Obama election? You were excited. We got 61% turnout. It's not that great. But, I mean, it's great comparatively, but, you know, we could do better, can't we? And in the midterm, we got 41% turnout in 2010. That's really something. In our congressional races nowadays, millions of dollars are spent, and yet turnout is routinely pretty lackluster. I'm not bragging, but I'll tell you this. I got 262,000 votes. Six people got more votes than me in my district. I mean, not in my district, in the country, in the Congress. But I say that by comparison, because there was the district next to me, the winner won with 170,000. So I'll say those numbers again. My district, I got 262,000. The district next to me got 170. That was Michelle Bachmann's district. And Michelle won her race by 4,000 votes. We spent about $800,000 in my race. She spent $12
million. Oh, my God.
So you see what I'm saying? We're spending all kinds of money. The vote turnout is not that good. What are we doing? Something that we're doing is actually, the money we're spending is not to enhance turnout. Because if we were, the more money, the more turnout. I guarantee you, if I give you $1 million and I get $1 million and I spend my money on door knocking, phone calling, and try to increase the turnout, and you spend yours on just trying to win, and your basic strategy is to convince everybody that your opponent is a bad person, then my turnout will be way higher than yours. You know, negative campaigning is a piece of, I think, why people are disengaged and don't really turn out to vote. In fact, the whole theory of negative campaigning is not to convince the voter that, you know, to switch. It is to demoralize the other person's base. So we just go down. So you thought your candidate was so good? Well, did you know this about him? You know? And so they're like, well, you know, no, I didn't know that. You know what? The heck with the whole thing. And so we've got to figure out ways to get people more involved, more engaged, to care more. No doubt politics plays a significant role in the life of all of us. I mean, you know, war and peace, taxation, addressing poverty, our environment, big issues at stake. And yet people, you know, aren't that plugged in. So I think one of the things we could do is we need to find strategies that would make it not a good thing, not a good strategy to just rip on your opponent. One of the things we're doing in Minneapolis, not in our state, not at the national, but in Minneapolis, is we have ranked choice voting. And so basically, if you got, you know, several candidates, you don't say, I like this one or I vote for that one, which gives the candidates the incentive to saying, that person's bad and I'm good. Sometimes they don't even say I'm good. They say I'm not as bad as that guy. You rank them. You say, this one, I like this one best. I like this one second best. I like this one third best. Now, if I am inclined to say my opponent is a bad, bad, bad person, you know, and they're bad, and I can think of a lot of reasons why, that would be a problem if I was trying to win, because, you know, I might get my own ones, but I would want to get my opponent's twos or threes. See what I'm saying? So it really wouldn't be a good idea to go on and on about how bad they were. It would be better for me to say, my idea about this is better, but I do see how candidate X over there has a point. I might be able to execute it better, but I think that what they want to do around, I don't know, water rights would be a good thing. And that means their twos, my opponent's twos, they might score one for my opponent, but maybe they'll score two for me because I've acknowledged something about my opponent that might be a good thing. Now, we've had a few iterations of this in Minneapolis. It's still new, working out kinks. In certain parts of town, we had a number of spoiled ballots. Got to be candid about that. But I think that's not the problem of ranked choice voting. It's the problem of voter education. You do have to go into the neighborhood and say, this is how you do it. And you need voter education in any case. And so I'm looking for ways to diminish the polarization. We are polarizing Congress. You know, the farm bill just failed. I didn't celebrate it. I don't think it's good for the farm bill to fail. There's a lot of people depending upon the farm bill. I couldn't vote for it because it cut $20 billion out of food stamps. And, you know, I don't believe the richest country in the world is too broke to take care of poor people and help them. So I wasn't voting for it. Folks in the Heritage Foundation were running ads against Frank Lucas, the Republican chair of the Ag Committee, because there were some money in there for food stamps. Get it? So about $20 billion made us, you know, many of us in the Democratic side, maybe even some of the Republican, I don't think so, but maybe some, go no. And some folks didn't want to see one single penny in for food stamps and urged a no because of that. So that is polarization. It's bad. It's toxic polarization. It's not a good thing at all. And it has resulted in Congress going even lower in the esteem of the American people. And we've got to do something about it. Just to illustrate the point a little bit more. So, remember that gentleman, Joe Wilson, who yelled, "You lie," at the president's State of the Union speech? Remember that guy? Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, I know him. He's not a mean person. In fact, he's actually pleasant. We were all kind of surprised when it happened. Now, look, he's a pretty conservative guy. Me and him don't vote the same way. But in terms of just interaction, he's fine to be around. Do you know he got his campaign coffers flooded when he did that? Now, he was a gentleman, and just knowing him, I kind of thought that he probably had second thoughts about what he did. I can't say that for a fact. But if he had any, they were washed away by all that money that came in his campaign. On the other side, you know, I actually do regret getting into shouting match with Sean Hannity. People praise me about it. I say, please don't do that. I'm not proud of that. You know, happened. Not ashamed of it. I got campaign donations. I got like $36,000 right after that.
Wow.
Now, my point is that somehow, some way, we're rewarding like bad behavior, right? I mean, and we're not talking about bad people. I don't think I'm that bad of a person. I know Joe Wilson isn't. And yet, in our not best moments, that's when the money's coming in. You see what I'm saying? Now, people are people, and people make mistakes. That's just being human. That's the problem is when the most inflammatory things happen is when folks get engaged. It's not that Congress is all that polarized. It is. Americans are somewhat polarized. And then the other Americans are just checked out. Most people don't listen to Rush Limbaugh or Rachel Maddow. They watch Dancing with the Stars or American Idol or whatever. We've got to find a way to reach in and engage people so that they don't feel that politics is that icky and it's important for them to be engaged. And I think we need to look for ways to depolarize Congress and the country.
Thank you, Bob.
We'll hear a little bit more about ranked choice voting during this talk. One stat, I'm a sort of numbers person sometimes. Oakland is another city that went to ranked choice voting. They had 18 offices elected by the system. Their 18 winners, 16 of them won with more votes than the previous winner in the non-ranked choice voting system, which is part of this inclusion requirement almost. You've got to build your support and you've got to get more votes when more people participate in elections where they had more choices. The combination of both more choices and ultimately winning with more votes is a great combination. When we talk about inclusion, there is a big gap in this country that our next speaker can address. We're very fortunate to have Marie Wilson with us, past president of the Ms. Foundation, founder and president of the White House Project, author of multiple books, including Closing the Leadership Gap, Why Women Can and Must Help Run the World. She's involved with us in our new Representation 2020 project. And thanks so much for being here, Marie.
Thank you. One of the things that I think is most discouraging and would be a shot in the arm for our democracy and change many things is if we actually had enough women in power and in politics. And most, what's so amazing, by the way, is I've been working on this for quite a while. Most of the people in this country think that we really are and represented equally, that you have a diversity of women and it's equal. So I spent years at the Ms. Foundation and saw that the people we were funding out there, the women's movement, a great deal with the government in exile, because they were picking up the pieces of what government wasn't providing and healthcare and all these things. And I started the White House Project a little over a decade ago because I said, you know, we ought to get them to be the government in power. And what we have right now, which is hard in this last election because everybody's like, I cannot hardly stand the year of the woman again. I mean, if we have another year of the woman, I'm leaving this country because we haven't had a minute of the woman yet. And that was, you know, everyone was celebrating. But when you are supposedly the leading democracy and you're going from 17 to 20 women in the Senate, and when you're a leading democracy and you're finally getting to about 18% of the House, and what I think is the most amazing thing is that women have been stuck at 23 to 24% of the state legislatures of America forever. And so what you really don't have in terms of a democracy is the full and fair participation of half your folks, a diversity of women. I mean, even Warren Buffett is out there talking about we're going down the tubes if we don't get women in some of these positions. But part of what we do, and what we did at the White House Project, I mean, we do a lot of things right. We do a lot of things about looking at how the media treats women and trying to get better media practices. We do training. We don't train near enough women. I mean, we train thousands of women. During my time at the White House Project, we trained 10 and 12,000 because we started training 50 and 100 at once, you know, because women won't run if they're not trained. I mean, they look at there and they don't see men look and see men, and they think it would be fine to run, but women don't see women. And therefore, it's discouraging for them to run, and there are many other reasons too. But part of what bothers me is in this country, when we want to change something, whether it's people of color or women, whatever outside group, we fix them. We say, if we can just fix you, we can get you trained up, get you blushed up, we can get you out there. But it's structures that need fixing. And whether it's the corporate world or the political world or whatever, it's structures. And I got involved with Fair Vote eventually because this is the only project that I know that is looking at a structural way to really change things. Because as long as we have the kind of problems we have with raising money for elections, and as long as we have the kind of problems we have at attracting women into power, as long as we haven't had a national child care bill in this country in 40 years, and we don't provide the kind of things that allow both women and men to participate fully and fairly in our system, then we don't have a way to get enough women into office. So what I got intrigued by was what Rob was doing, it's not you personally, is it? What Fair Vote was doing, particularly with multi-member districts. It is very hard to get a woman to run in a single member district. The party is not going to recruit her, we know that. You recruit her, you're like sending her into the wolves because it's an outsider. And of course, it's a district that's already set before she gets in. So if you took the state, which I like, sometimes we use the state of Massachusetts, and instead of you have nine congressional districts, and you have nine white people in those districts, one woman, eight men, and you have no diversity, and it's not going to change. But if you were to have three districts that had three members in it, women would get in. People of color would get in. I mean, you would have diversity because you have a chance of actually being voted for by enough of your constituents. Now, when you go out and talk to people about women in power, you always tell them, and particularly in power in this country, that we are always between 47th and 57th in the world in terms of the number of women in political leadership here. Sometimes we are in our 90s in terms of the countries that are ahead of us. And they are doing well. Most of the women in the countries that have more women are doing well. But the single reason that they have it is some of them have quotas. And you know we will never do quotas, right? No. In this country, anytime I have tried everything, like, what if we said quota? You know, would it make you feel better? But you can't make it any way that they will do it. But, other countries do quotas for women in power. They have, a different voting system. They have parliamentary systems, and they get to power. We will never do that. And so one of the only things you could do is to start to change the structure, how people get elected, how they vote. And these are not always easy things. I think we were talking earlier about sometimes they scare people. You have to do the math, maybe. But it's not that scary if we don't change the structure. We will never be a democracy. And so one of the things we're working on, of course, that you mentioned, and I'll close with that, is a lot of us are working on something called 2020, Representation 2020, because we should be a country that has parity in the number of women in power. The real reason is our winner-take-all elections. That is the single reason that we are behind. Now, I know everybody will swear to you that she said this, but I don't believe her. There's got to be women in this country, and it was a great year of the woman. But it is really not true, because when you are this low down in terms of the number of women in power in this country, when you have five women governors, and the governorships are the keys to even ever getting in office. So I'm going to close with this, though. It looks like we might have a woman running for president. And it's looking really positive in the last few years. I'm not going to say anything about parties up here because you're not allowed. But it looks like we might have a woman running again, and Hillary Clinton. And so I'd like to propose to you that the next two or three years would be a really good time to focus on starting where democracy has really stopped, and that is encouraging women to run. I was also the co-founder of Take Our Daughters to Work in America. And all those girls grew up thinking they were going to be something. And so I think we owe them a little help here. So I'm pleased to be a part of this project. Thank you.
Thank you, Marie. As I mentioned, multi-seat districts are part of our history. 100 years ago, actually, more than half of state legislators were elected from multi-seat districts. Maryland still has them. They do use winner-take-all. But here's an interesting statistic. The states that have multi-seat districts, and there's at least seven, in every single one of them, more than half of the voters end up having a representative who's a woman in the state legislature. Right. So that sense of being represented is quite different. And they tend to have a higher percentage of women as well, and that different level of access. Another statistic, before we turn it over to our final speaker here, is that House of Representatives, and we've talked about multi-seat districts. We've heard from a congressman talk some about the experience of being in the House. The single-member district creates a condition where really like 1 of 10 districts has a chance to change next year. There's a couple of slides that we've had around and about and that we've been working on that show a couple of problems that I just wanted to make sure that you take a look at, because they speak to different things that are wrong with the House that are good lead-in to our next speaker, which is that one is the issue of partisan bias, that in any sort of fair system, we think that whoever gets more votes should usually win more seats. That's sort of a basic level of democracy. If you look at the 2014 elections and the way that the single-member districts and where the voters' bases of power are and how degree of concentrated each one is, the Democratic Party's candidates, if they got as much as 55% of the vote, would probably still not win at least half the seats. They actually, basic preference was 52 to 48 in 2012, and that did not win half the seats. You see variations of that at the local level, at the state level, for different parties. But that obviously creates a certain dynamic in how the House operates. We also are in a position where, as Congressman Porter mentioned, that sense of feeling like a moderate voice within the Republican caucus, moderate voices within the Democratic caucus. There's been a dramatic change in how many such people there are, and it's not reflective of the voters where they might be, right? In that sense of these multi-seat districts. So we drew multi-seat districts for every state in the country. Real numbers, you can look at fairvoting.us and see what they look like. Every single one of them, using a modest statutory candidate-based system, would result in both parties winning seats, a sort of a mix of who within the parties won seats, likely more women, an expansion of how many racial minorities elect candidates of choice, sort of like this magic solution, but it actually can be done. This turns me to Norm Ornstein, because he's written extremely powerful books about Congress, the state of how it works, one of the most quoted men in America on politics, a scholar at the American Enterprise Institute. He's written a number of books. Two of them are The Permanent Campaign and Its Future, and most recently with Thomas Mann, It's Even Worse Than It Looks, How the American Constitutional System Collided with the New Politics of Extremism. So, Norm.
Thanks, Rob, and I'm delighted to be here with everybody on this panel, many of whom I've worked with a lot of different things. I want to start just in a broader sense. I've been in Washington for almost 44 years now, and I've never seen it this dysfunctional. And our politics nationally have become far more dysfunctional, and they're tribal at this point. You can deal with polarization in a range of important issues. Many of them are not inherently ideological. There's nothing left or right about energy conservation, for example. And even those where there are sharp differences in worldview, you can find ways to either find common ground or compromise. But tribalism is where you say, if you're for it, I'm against it, even if I was for it yesterday. And that's what dominates this process now. And it's no way to run a country, and it's no way to operate. And as I've looked at this process carefully and looked at the system and looked at ways of dealing with it, and the second half of the book, It's Even Worse Than It Looks, is on solutions or ways out of it, you quickly come to the conclusion that we can make changes inside Congress, we can make changes inside the system. They're not going to resolve a lot of these issues. First of all, they become cultural in nature. I think, you know, Keith was talking about that a little bit, that now, if you lie, if you behave badly, you're rewarded. There's no sense of shame anymore. And if you lie, the lesson you learn is you double down on that lie and you'll get your own cable television show, or you can become a presidential candidate for Minnesota. So it's a big problem. But if we're going to look at structural ways of changing things, we first have to look at the election system and the voting system. And in a whole host of ways, I believe we have to move beyond the fact that fringe extreme groups are dominating this process now. Now, I think it's going to require changes in the utterly corrupt money system in American politics, triggered by Citizens United, but dominated by many more things. But we have to enlarge the electorate. We have to make voting easier. And there are a lot of ways of doing that. And after the not just misguided decision on the Voting Rights Act yesterday, I think, to me, it was the most shocking misuse of judicial power and an activist that I've ever seen. I believe in deference to the legislature, more generally, and bending over backwards to accept legislative outcomes. Where you make a distinction is generally in matters that involve rights. And that's why I think the decision yesterday on DOMA was the correct decision. But on voting rights, the explicit language of the 15th Amendment is as clear as could be. If you are a strict constructionist and you believe in the language of the Constitution, you don't have the leeway to take an act of Congress passed unanimously in one body and near unanimously in another after extensive work and discussion and debate and deliberation. That's putting a thumb in the eye of the Constitution, in my view. So that's a personal view and an aside. But it suggests to me that it's time for a major push for a Voting Rights Act 2.0 that includes a lot of different things that will make voting easier, many of which have been promoted actively and with enormous energy and intelligence by Rob and Chris and Fair Vote. I'd go beyond that. I'd like to move election day to the weekend. If I could, I would have... if I could wave a magic wand, I would have mandatory attendance at the polls, as they do in Australia. We're not going to do that. And in the process of not doing that, we have to look towards other things. Now, just a couple of other comments based on what we've said here today. The problem is not just redistricting in the House. It's also the big sort. People have sorted themselves out geographically. And the fact is we have more and more districts that are not just safe for one party, but they've become homogeneous echo chambers. So when people go back home, what they hear is the same thing reinforced over and over again. You need to have heterogeneity in representation. Representatives have to know that they have a fiduciary responsibility to represent a much broader group. And that's where any redistricting reform is not going to do the trick if we keep with single-member districts. We have to think more broadly and create a kind of representation where people don't just represent an urban area, don't just represent white Americans. Even if you are, I had a long talk some time ago with Bob Livingston, a former congressman from Louisiana, who had a very conservative Republican district, and he's a very conservative guy, but when he was there, they had 19 or 20% African-American representation. And what Livingston would say to me is, you know, they weren't going to vote for me. But one, I have a fiduciary responsibility to represent everybody in my district. And two, the last thing I wanted to do was piss them off so much that they would turn out in enormous numbers and embarrass me. So it changed the way he talked about issues and the way he thought about issues. And we need to look at things in that way. At the same time, if we look at ways of reducing the impact of extremists in the system, and finding in a two-party system constructive ways for third or fourth parties or independents or those who now feel, as so many Republicans do, forced out of their own party. It's been hijacked by lunatics. What are you going to do? You know, a lot of them are not going to feel comfortable becoming Democrats, and it's not necessarily the way in which you want to go. How do you get that voice out there in a constructive way? And that's why open primaries and things like the open primary in California are big steps in the right direction, but they're not enough. What we've seen in California is, for example, one instance where you had an overwhelmingly Democratic district with tons of Democrats running and two Republicans, and in an open primary with a top two being able to run in the general election and basically the first past the post system, all the Democrats divided their votes, and the voters in that district had a choice of two Republicans, and they happened to be very conservative Republicans. That wasn't a very good way in which to go. So what Fair Vote has come up with, which I think is a very constructive way of doing this, is to move it to a top four system with preference voting. And on that basis, you're going to get a wider panoply of candidates, opportunities for those who are not necessarily comfortable in one of the two major parties now. But you're also going to see that extremist candidates are not going to win by being able to divide other votes and get a sliver of the votes. And people across the board are going to be able to have their preferences expressed. Most often, it's going to be one of the two major party candidates who will win. And that's fine. But those candidates and candidates who run are going to know that they'd better reach out to other forces and not occupy a sliver of the space that now tends to be dominated by more extreme movements. So we're not going to get, until we get a change in the Supreme Court, a different political money system. We are not all that likely at this point without a major push by everybody here and a whole lot more to get the Voting Rights Act 2.0, but we, I think, have a moral obligation to do that and to try and to push as hard as we possibly can. There are other things to push for that, as we've seen with California, have a chance of success and with a tweak can become much, much more constructive. And this has to be a national priority, because if we don't make some of these changes, this system becomes more tribal. It's metastasized out to so many states. It's becoming sectarian in the country. We know what happens to countries that fall back into sectarianism. We had it here 150 years ago. We've seen it in Yugoslavia and in other places. It's not out of the question that this great country could end up with a much, much deeper dysfunction.
So we're going to break into our programming to do something that we are really pleased to do, which is to honor two members of Congress who are here. Both of them have truly earned our respect, and their work is what we call champions of democracy. We'll give two more awards during our reception, but these are active working people who have to actually go back and vote on the Hill. We'd first like to make sure we catch Congressman Ellison before he leaves. And Jamie, can you come up and maybe help me say a few words about the congressman? And I'll repeat that the issue of the right to vote in the Constitution, which I think goes beyond Voting Rights Act 2.0, but is fundamental about putting the explicit right to vote. Is a new way that the congressman is taking a leadership role on democracy, but it's not the first, and I'm sure not the last. And Congressman and Senator Raskin, maybe Congressman someday, has worked closely with the congressman. I thought I could say a few words.
Yeah, well, thank you, Rob. I'd be delighted to say a few words about Keith Ellison. He, to me, embodies the spirit of Fair Vote, which is about liberating the creative capacities and imagination of everybody in the country to be the most effective political actors we can in the interest of the common good. And so he's been the great champion of a constitutional amendment on the right to vote, of mobilizing the unregistered and getting them registered, galvanizing people to participate in elections, and then the critical and difficult work of transforming the technological infrastructure of electoral systems so that everybody's vote counts, everybody's vote is meaningful. So he's got a long-range vision at the same time that he's able to pay very close attention to the needs of his constituents in Minnesota. So he's a role model to all of us, and I think it's great that you recognize him with your Champion of Democracy Award.
So, well, thank you, Congressman. Can you? Well, we have a massive award.
All right.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
And there you go. And do you have some words before I know you have to leave shortly? But there we go.
Well, thank you for this wonderful award. We're going to put it in our office and display it prominently because we're proud of it. I just want to say a few other things. I was just talking to Norm Ornstein about ideas. And I just want to emphasize that all of the best ideas will be fueled by your energy, your power. So we definitely need you to get ready for a real fight because of everything we discussed today, but also because you know, there's a country, the greatest country in the world, in my opinion, that needs you. And this is a call to service, to really defend democracy. A few other just simple ideas I want to throw out there. What if we said to people, the great numbers of incarcerated, that when they get out, they can vote? This would do a lot of good for our democracy. I actually introduced a bill that said that in federal elections, you should be able to vote. Let me tell you, the statistics show that voting is pro-social behavior and associated with law-abiding behavior. So the cops should like it. It's cheaper. You don't have to have the Secretary of State running around figuring out who can vote, who can't, you know? And then also, it speaks to our belief in redemption, that you're not the worst thing you ever did, and that, you know, you can be back a part of this society again. That's an idea that I hope you all embrace, because our country incarcerates more people than any other country in the world, and has a higher percentage too, and there's whole legions of people who are locked out of participation. They have to abide by every law, but they don't have any opportunity to participate in making those laws. And so I hope you'll consider that idea as we move forward as well. Thank you all very much.
Hey, thank you. We've also been joined by Congressman James Clyburn. So, welcome. And I first met Congressman Clyburn almost 20 years ago, I think, in the wake of one of the Supreme Court rulings at that time about voting rights and redistricting. And we were on a TV show together, and I was making points about how we could look to cumulative voting and changes to winner-take-all. And the congressman was on was defending the idea of the Voting Rights Act being used to create opportunities for racial minorities to win seats through majority-minority districts. And then we talked in the break, and he said, but I've always loved cumulative voting, and I have worked for this, and I've raised it, and it started a discussion that has continued ever since. During those years, the congressman has risen into power within the Democratic Party. He is currently was the House Majority Whip and is currently the Assistant Democratic Leader. There's a line that from your biography that the president said of you, that he's one of a handful of people who, when they speak, the entire Congress listens. And I think that as we have this conversation about the vote, Voting Rights Act 2.0, winner take all, where we go from here, I am looking forward for opportunities to raise this question again of winner take all and moving forward, and that having the whole Congress listen. And so we are so pleased that you could join us. We wanted to give you this Champion of Democracy Award for that history of raising this. I know with letters to state legislators in South Carolina, writing op-eds in your newspapers and in meetings on the Hill, continuing to say this is something we should look to. So as someone who is high within your party, but still saying we should need to look at changes that open up the system for more of us, we are honored to give you a Champion of Democracy Award. What do you think about all that?
Well, first of all, let me thank you very much for recognizing me, and so good to see former friends. A good friend. It's great to be here with all of these people who I hold in very, very high esteem. This is my 21st year in the Congress, but long before I came to the Congress, I have been advocating for a significant return to cumulative voting. And I say that because if you look at our history, you will realize that we did not get mired into what we call winner-take-all elections really until the 1890s, when as a way of diluting the vote in this instance of African Americans, Southern states, in adopting their new constitutions, went to these winner-take-all elections. South Carolina, at one point, had two-thirds of his General Assembly. Was black in the 1870s and 1880s. A lot of people don't realize that at all, but one of his congresspeople was black. And in order to negate all of that is the reason we went to winner-take-all elections. I think it's kind of interesting if you remember, and I bring this up, Mandela's been on my mind for obvious reasons. But when the negotiations took place over going forward after Mandela and blacks were allowed into the mainstream of the South African government, the very first thing that was negotiated was to get rid of winner-take-all elections. That's the very first thing. If you go back, you check. That's what they did. Because the white population knew that as a minority, their best chances of being represented and of representing would be with cumulative voting or preference voting. I think you, Rob, you've sort of left me a little bit. I think you're calling it choice voting now, right?
Choice voting, yeah.
I'm with you, Norm. Preference voting. PV has always been it for me. PV and CV. That's where I've been for a long time. I do believe that we ought to have a serious discussion of this. Now, because I defend the Voting Rights Act of 1965, I think if you check the history of this, you will see in many settlements of voting rights cases, we went to cumulative voting. I remember, in fact, if my memory serves, I think, what's this funny name kind of in Alabama? That's adjacent to Shelby. They used cumulative voting to settle the voting rights case there. And the result was the first African-American elected to the council. And I understand that the racial voting is much less polarized today than it's ever been. So I really am pleased for this recognition. I've caught a lot of flack for this, mostly from people who do not understand it and people who do not know our history. I think the best example, current example, was Illinois. Illinois had cumulative voting up to the 1980s, I believe.
1982.
And that's how so many African Americans in Illinois got elected and were able to make names for themselves and able to tramp down the racial voting and became acceptable. Now, there's no way to prove this, but I think it's kind of interesting that in current times, especially on the Democratic side, both of our permanent senators of color came out of Illinois. Mm-hmm. Think about that. And I think a lot of it had to do because of the foundation that was laid, the cumulative voting. I'm very much for us taking a look at some alternatives to the winner-take-all elections because we would be much less balkanizing. I think we would be much more representative. And I really believe it could lead to substantial reduction in racializing. Thank you so much.
So we may have our members slip out at some point, but it's just because they have to vote on the Hill. But thank you, Congressman. Wonderful words. We were going to try to, in the spirit of, because this is being live streamed and recorded for the web, and it's hard to kind of have your voices part of that, or your faces at least, to have questions asked via writing down your comments. So why don't we start that process? If we could put some cards through, you can pass questions to the side. While we're collecting some of those, I know that you've all had a chance to speak, but not in a chance to interact much. Were there any questions or comments you might want to raise to each other at this point?
I got a thing I'd like to say. It occurred to me halfway through that maybe people didn't know what pro bono representation was. And we ought to make very clear that pro bono for the good is really for free. And so if we asked Rob and fairvote.org to be the client, it would be for no cost.
Well, that's a double honor then. Thank you, Congressman.
I have a question. Now, I could ask my dear friend Whip Clyburn this question later, but I want you all to hear the answer. Sure. So, Congressman Clyburn, we know that last time you all reauthorized the Voting Rights Act, I had not quite gotten to Congress. You all had done it in 2006. We had a lot of support on both sides of the aisle. Even, you know, Congressman Stensenbrenner, Goodlatte, I mean, leaders in Congress today.
Sure.
Is that going to carry over now that we've got to, we have a chance to fix the Section 4?
Well, there's some interesting votes in the Senate today. I think the Senate confirmed Anthony Foster there 100-0. Yeah. And I kept looking at the thing thinking it was a misprint. When we reauthorized the Voting Rights Act the last time, 2006, the vote in the Senate was 98-0 to reauthorize. It was 390-33 on the House side. And as you say, Stensenbrenner just took possession of it. I mean, he managed the development of that 15,000 pages of a record, which I thought was a good record. Now, I cannot say that the Supreme Court was disingenuous in looking at the 1972 record and saying it was out then. I'm not going to say that. But when I look at some of the reasoning, participation versus all other kind of shenanigans that take place when you do this, David Price said to me today, early this morning, I was sitting right behind him, he leaned back, he says, I didn't fully understand what you were saying right after this decision until I saw the headlines coming out of North Carolina. Because they are now putting forth a piece of legislation that's going to be very comprehensive, and he just went through all the stuff that they're putting in there, and it's going to be in law, because they're going to pass it, and the governor's going to sign it. And I believe we're going to have to live with some of this for a period of time. So that's a long way of saying to you, I do not believe that we will get that kind of result out of the House or the Senate this time. All you need is one senator to object to the process, and we'll get tied up for some time. And I really believe there is at least one senator that would object to us getting it done.
Yeah.
Wow.
Thank you.
So we do have some good questions. Feel free to continue to interact. It looks like we may be about to lose someone here. But here was the first one that I thought was I wanted to put out there. Many of the reform ideas discussed and advanced are perfectly reasonable and would do much to improve American democracy. Great. But implementing such reforms seems to require partisan self-dealing among elected officials to act contrary to their personal self-interest, or perhaps. How many reform advocates align their interests of democracy with the interests of the very people who would need to pass the appropriate legislation? Meaning, I think the way I would interpret that is partly the partisan dynamics and the complexity of sort of aligning oneself with one party, and then also the personal versus the right thing, like whether people are going to fear changing the rules that elected them, even if it might be better for Congress overall. So those are a couple questions maybe you all could grapple with.
Well, I mean, I'll start. It's a serious uphill battle. Everybody, first of all, will look at this through the prism of their own experiences. And if we're talking about Congress, everybody got elected. So the system, awful as it may be, worked for them. And there is a natural reluctance to implement change where you have no idea how it will work. But the second phenomenon, which I think also explains why we have such a different atmosphere on voting rights, Even 2006, it was a different universe than we have now. The level of polarization was just much, much less. And now it's a different, where I think the level of consciousness among Republicans of the changing demographics of America were less as well. So it's just going to be harder to do a lot of these things. It's always been hard to do these things. We may not be able to do it until things get a whole lot worse before they get a whole lot better. But you have to lay the groundwork, and you have to put it out there. And among other things, as Jim said, people don't know what these things are. You have to explain to them why these seemingly bizarre ideas that are not a part of our normal political lexicon are actually common sense ideas, and to make them work better. And I think with a major education, Americans know this system is not working the way it's supposed to work. And we have to come up with compelling reasons for doing it. If that happens, then we can begin to get some changes done in Congress.
Historically, most of the policy changes in America have come up through the system, up through the municipalities, the states, and to the federal government. And it seems to me that the federal government, as Norm just said, is really probably impossible to get it done there. So it seems to me you've got to look at what we can do in various states and then get something going, some momentum behind change. This progressive movement in 1900, or right around that 1900, swept the country, and it brought in primary elections everywhere. We've got to get the same kind of movement going that sweeps the country and start with some states we can pick off and move on, and have the changes come through initiative that is brought by the people, not by the people who are living, as Norm says, according to the system that elected them. Why would they want to change it? So,
can I just add one thing? One of the things that I think Frank Rich talked about so well right after the Tea Party movement was that this was a country that was acting like it did after the civil rights legislation of the 60s, in fear. And I liked what you said about tribal, because I think we have to acknowledge that what's underneath the surface of all this, to some extent, is a fear of the dwindling white race, a fear of what's happening with women and men, of gender, a fear of change that is really occurring. And the only thing, the way that I keep thinking about Frank is that I think you can't just talk to people about these things. I think you have to show them films. I think you have to show them documentaries. I think you have to reach them somewhere in their hearts and actually have them be inspired again about a country that is a diverse country. And when we did train people, we took a film about Shirley Chisholm all over America, because young women had never seen a woman like Shirley Chisholm. And right now, she made a great film about Angela Davis recently too. But I think we need to inspire people and realize that fear is not going to give way. I think this stuff is a lot fear-based.
I want to make one other point, Rob, which is something I was talking about with John before we started. To me, the great tragedy of the Supreme Court decision yesterday, I think will be the great tragedy, is for a Republican Party which has to grapple with what Lindsey Graham called a demographic death spiral, you got two ways of responding. One way is you reach out and communicate with voters who are antagonistic towards you and approach them in a different way, with different policies, with different rhetoric. A second is you say, to hell with that, we'll just suppress their votes. And what the decision yesterday does is to give enormous leverage to those who are just going to say the easy way out. We'll just keep them from voting. And that's not just African Americans and Hispanic Americans. It's women. It's young people. It's those who are outside their ken now. And instead of an incentive to have a party move towards the middle and towards the country as a whole, it's an encouragement to dig in with a narrower slice of the vote. And that, as we've seen with now these actions in Texas, the actions in North Carolina, and a whole lot of other places, is really, really bad for the country.
Rob, can I follow up?
Yes.
It seems to me that America needs a democracy reform movement. writ large. And it begins with a constitutional amendment on the right to vote, which Fair Vote has been pushing. You know, we don't have a constitutional, an affirmative constitutional right to vote in the Constitution. We've got a series of ragtag anti-discrimination amendments. You can't discriminate on the basis of race. You can't discriminate on the basis of sex, and so on. But nowhere do we have what you have if you open up the new South African Constitution, which is everybody's got a right to vote at every level of government over them. And so we've got 500,000 people right here in Washington, D.C., who have no representation in Congress, millions in the territories. We've got millions of ex-felons, people who've done good time, they've gotten out, and they can't vote. So we start with that. We start then with national voting standards. But then we do have to get to this representation question that Congressman Clyburn is talking about. Now, the state legislatures are the ones who draw the districts. And as I was suggesting when I first started, the problem is that we're locked into an arms race mentality. State legislators don't often hear from their members of Congress, but every 10 years, we hear a lot from them. And they wake us up in the morning, and before we go to bed at night, it's, I want my district to be this and that, and I want that neighborhood and that. And everybody's locked into a very narrow, careerist, personal agenda, how I want my district to be. And nobody is talking about how we move to democracy 2.0, the next generation of representative elections. So I'm very hopeful, listening to Congressman Clyburn, that we can build a national movement for legislation that would repeal the single-member district requirement, replace it with nonpartisan expert or interpartisan expert commissions that would draw multi-member districts and get people elected this way. And that's how we will deal with the gender issue. And it may be that feminism will be the cause that brings us there, because everything you said was absolutely right. If we divided Maryland up into two super districts and had four people elected from each, do you think that the Democrats or Republicans would be running four men in each district? No, there'd be two men and two women. And as you're saying, more women would be likely to run where it's not that kind of cutthroat, dog-eat-dog kind of single-member district election. But the other thing is that in order to attract the voters, we want to make the candidates as reflective as possible of it. So, it's like the National Popular Vote Plan, which I was very proud to be the first person to introduce in America in Maryland, and everybody said it's crazy, it'll never go. It's too complicated. People won't understand it. And you know what? Politics is about education, if it's done right. And we educated people, and we passed it. And now we're halfway there in terms of a national popular vote. And 75 or 80% of Americans want to not have the electoral college system the way we practice it today. They want to have a national popular vote plan. And I think it's going to be the exact same thing in terms of proportional voting as soon as we package it the right way, translate it for people, and make it a cause about representing everybody, regardless of gender and race and party.
Thank you so much.
Videos.
I would say, and we have lots of questions, but that's a good question, that I just want to say this, which is as a way to segue into the next one, which is that 100 years ago, state legislatures gave up their power over choice of senators and turned it over to the people. So that's actually, a pretty big change for them to do, and that was 100 years ago with the 17th Amendment. 100 years ago, women weren't voting in many states. Then we got by 1920, the 19th Amendment, and doubling the franchise, right? And that's a pretty big change to your electorate. Kind of scary, but they did it, right? And primary elections, as Congressman Porter pointed out, those were a whole new idea 100 years ago. Not part of the Constitution, not part of something we did at all in the 19th century, and yet we're put in. So sometimes I think that we overestimate the difficulties of mobilizing the spirit for change. However, you got to seize those moments, and I think we're at a certain moment of breakage and collapse almost that creates certain conditions where this is possible. There was a very specific question that a couple of people raised that maybe Congressman Porter could comment on, which is just cumulative voting. Why was it removed in Illinois? And would you be able to comment on both that and any regrets you've heard from people since then?
Why was it removed? Because they put it on the ballot. The principal thrust for people to think about was reducing the size of the Illinois House, and politicians weren't any more popular then than they are now. And people simply wanted to cut back, get rid of The thing was, get rid of a third of them with one vote. Well, they did it. I don't think people had any idea of what they were doing, and I don't think they had any good understanding of why they needed to have cumulative voting and what it brought to the table. I think people weren't educated, basically, weren't educated as to what it was doing.
One sort of question that seems almost like a contradiction when one's talking about changing winner-take-all elections is part of the message is, and I'm summarizing a couple of questions here, is the there's too much extremism, and we need to go to a system that would promote more moderation and compromise. But we're also lowering what it takes to win, which would seemingly open the door toward new extremists maybe winning. And does anyone want to comment on maybe directly from the Illinois experience or what you know about other countries or your own thoughts about this, about what that might mean to say lower the threshold of what it takes to win to 20 to 25% in states across the country?
Well, let me just say on the extremism point, of course, extremism is in the eye of the beholder. Extremism is always the other guy. But we do know that there's a vast and deep gulf between the two political parties, which really represent two different political cultures, as I think Norm was saying, and it's moving more and more in that direction. That's because of the single member districts, the gerrymandered single member districts, where there's a blue district and there's a red district. So the other party drops out of competition, as well as the third and the fourth parties drop out of competition, and now you're just appealing to one base, and you're going to galvanize the people in that base by engaging in the most extreme anti the other side rhetoric that you can come up with. And so if the voters aren't looking to see, well, what's being actually done to move the ball forward on a whole range of public policy questions, foreign policy, and help, but they're just looking to see how well are you bashing the other side, then it's built into it. Now, if you move to the multi-member districts where people can get elected differently and say you do it with choice voting, preferential voting, as Keith was saying, I've got an interest now, if I'm not going to be your first choice, I want to be your second or your third. You know, a lot of my best legislation has been stuff that I've done with Republicans, medical marijuana, government spending transparency. There are lots of ways that we can get together if people are willing to open their minds to, you know, looking at the political spectrum differently. But everything with the structure of our political system right now militates towards division and animosity.
I just want to know, when it comes to women's issues, can it go any lower? No, I'm very serious.
You know. Well, first, it's not that you want to remove all people who might have extreme views. You know, there's going to be some representation there too. What's happened is all the incentives have moved so that what is really still a fairly small sliver of a population now has enormous additional influence. And you want the influence to be spread more widely. The fact is, with preference voting, you're not getting small slivers, one. Two, I would not be for a proportional representation system the way the Israelis or the Dutch or others have a proportional representation system, where you're going to end up with 20 parties represented in the legislature, and then the extreme groups can often have even more leverage because they can represent that balance of power. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about a system where if you had simply cumulative voting, it's true that you could get an extreme group that could mobilize and get people to say, here's our one candidate, we're going to cast all of our votes for that person. But that'll be one out of four, where now you could have four districts where every one of those primaries picks a person who's moving towards the polls and the extremes. Instead, the kinds of things that we're talking about provide for most of the candidates incentives to broaden your base rather than narrow your base. It's not going to work perfectly, no system would, but it's not going to result in an enhancement of extreme views, but the opposite.
So it's 2013, and 4 years from now, we gather here, and we're celebrating two or three accomplishments at any level of government that are the most exciting things that you could have imagined today would have happened, and they actually did over the next 4 years. I was just wondering if maybe each of you might comment on some changes
filibusters, changes in how we elect people, any other changes about the electoral process and structure that you think are within reach within 4 years. We'll just talk with whoever has their ideas first can maybe jump in.
Well, I think we'd be well served if we had three states that had moved to ranked choice voting and multiple member districts. I think that would be real progress.
For their state
for the state, yeah, because I think that would start something.
And I think John is on the right track. If we're looking for major victories at the federal level, we're likely to be disappointed. Now, it's possible the Supreme Court could change. You know, I sometimes say I'm all for a generous retirement fund for Anthony Kennedy. That might reverse Citizens United. Without that, we're not going to see major changes at that level. And it's possible we'll get a new Voting Rights Act. Actually, Jim Sensenbrenner, among others, has come out with a fairly strong statement about wanting to move forward. Even Eric Cantor did. How you operationalize that remains to be seen. But at the state level, where you've had citizens' commissions on redistricting now and other changes in several states, more states may move in that direction. And the experience has not been a horrible one, to say the least. Experiments with open primaries and now moving towards some other voting systems are not at all out of the question. We're getting in New York State a movement towards a much better campaign finance system with the New York City model of a multiple match for small donors that can really expand that base of small donors, which at the moment is the best way to be a counterweight against the huge money that's coming in otherwise. So we have to look at states that can provide models, and when we get those models and show how it works, and even go back and look at how well Illinois worked before a change compared to where it is afterwards, that is the best way to spread this around. But we have to look at this as a long game. It's not that we can look back in 4 years and say, thank God we've solved the problems. It's going to take us a while.
I think it's about changing the conversation. I actually think this is a very small group of people. It's a large group of people, but it's a small group of people. There are very few people in this country that actually understand or know much about this. And the ones who do are a little scared, and it looks like it has math attached to it, and you know, math anxiety. I mean, how many votes? But I don't think it's part of the national conversation. And I was just at something over in Paris last week where newspapers now have accepted the fact that they have to deal with digital. It's a big piece of their work. I mean, the whole thing has completely changed. They didn't come and say, we hate AOL, we hate Google. They came and said, okay, what are you doing? What are you doing? Le Monde, you're going to take over the world? I mean, it really has completely changed. And that's what has happened, though, is that people realized that it had to. And I don't think, Rob, that we have a country where this is anywhere near a conversation that very many people understand. So I think you have to be very creative about how you get it out. And of course, some models would be good, some successes would be good. But I think there are some people who are desperate and really desperate about this system. And if we really got a good campaign of getting people talking about it, it could give them some hope, because I think you're right. When you said tribal, I went, yeah, that's what's happening. So I'm for changing the conversation.
Great.
Okay.
We have food waiting. We also have more questions that haven't been asked, but we will have our speakers. I hope most of you can linger, or at least some of you can linger for a while. Can any all the Fairvote staffers and interns raise their hands for a moment? Look at all those people who would love to talk with you. So they have name tags on them, as I once did. And they will, we'd love to talk about our work.
Right.
We have our speakers here. We've got a terrific audience as well, who have a lot of experts and thoughtful people here. We will have a little short program out there as well, but not for a little bit. So thank you for coming, and we will continue this conversation.